Hi, and welcome to Wheelnerds. I'm Chuck. I'm DTF in the DSM down in the MCO. Holla! Hi. I'm here as part of our team. That was Roundtable.
I'll tell you when you're old enough.
Roundtable AIM Expo wrap up with a bunch of people. We got James from The Pace, Crash and Steve from the Cafe Racer, the Gear Dude, and this lady from Twisted Throttle.
I'm
Jessica
so
from Twisted Throttle.
Thank
Hello.
Thanks. Hello.
Hi, welcome to this wonderful Orlando, Florida room.
Jessica was dumb enough to follow us here.
You won't be leaving.
Wait a minute, I thought this was an LGBTQ meeting.
Wait, what?
What's the Q?
Yeah, what's the Q?
Really?
Yeah.
Show of hands, anyone know what the Q is?
I mean, is it the obvious, like, slang?
Yeah.
Okay, I guess I kind of assumed
like why,
it was...
Why is that necessary? Like, why does it get its own?
Doesn't that get covered under the...
Like, maybe so you own it. I don't know, it's like a, you know...
That's what I thought.
Yeah, I think it's kind of...
What?
It's kind of about owning it.
Yeah,
owning it. Be like, nah, it's, you know, it's...
I guess we haven't decided to go LGBTQF then.
No.
Because that's a little too derogatory.
Yeah.
Yeah.
LGBTQFH?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You gotta get the H.
Yeah.
You can't...
You want to just run the entire alphabet?
Yeah.
Yeah, an ABC...
There's probably an insult attached to every single letter.
You need the H.
We could do it.
James need the H.
Are we doing a show here?
Oh,
yes, we are doing a show.
Thank you, moderator.
Yes, thank you. So we've had 2 days of AIM Expo. We've all been looking at stuff, riding bikes, talking to people. Jessica has been an exhibitor at AIM Expo, and you know, let's start with that. How are you? Is this your first AIM?
Right, it is my first AIM.
What do you think?
How are you going to do this for 2 more days?
Yeah,
that is exactly what I've been asking
myself.
I've been on the couch for like 40 minutes. How are you going to do this?
Oh my gosh, I'm not sure. Because I'm also, since I'm a media PR person, my job is pretty much to talk all day long, to, you know, entertain people, tell stories, try and sell them on what a great stuff we do, etc. So,
and we've dragged you here to do just that. Tell us a story.
It wasn't bad enough from
entertain
like...
Entertain us.
Yes. Please, I would like to talk much more all day.
But, we're waiting, yeah. Go ahead.
Actually, honestly, it's been pretty great. I think, for me, just being around the industry and all the people in it for a couple of days is pretty awesome. Because there's a lot of people you don't see very often, live all over the country, and this is a pretty close-knit industry. It's one of those things where it's still a cottage industry. There's big companies in it, but we're all enthusiasts, and we're like, it's not like being in some giant corporate environment, or we don't, no offense to dentists, but we're not like a dental convention. You know, this is a passion industry, so when you see each other, it's a lot more fun. And so, yeah.
The big corporations are the bike makers, and they just kind of drop it like shit from the sky. And then, you know, like Twisted Throttle or, you know, Tour Tech. You guys are the cottage part, right?
It's fun being scrappier. I feel like we're you know, the fighters, like, sort of down and more at the base level, and we're just trying to do, like, weird different things, and we're not really governed by politics at all. You know, we can be obnoxious. We can be a little crazy. We can have fun and be ourselves, and if you don't like it, then you don't really have to deal with us.
It's really easy to make personal connection with people, right? Because we all have something in common.
Yeah.
Right? We've all got something to talk about.
That's right. We do, so. James.
Aww, it's kind of like an AA meeting.
You had to.
Yeah, pretty much.
Creepy Chuck showed up tonight. Just saying.
What?
No, it's, you know what's funny is, like, you get
Why
that.
Why did I sit here?
You get the sense from, like, the corporate, the big manufacturers and everything, that they're totally stuffed shirts. And that they're... Like, even when we crack jokes around them, like, we pissed off the Honda guy. We talked about this yesterday.
Yeah, but that's easy to do.
Yeah, well, I mean, I've done that with Yamaha, too. Like, when I told him how ugly the SR400 was, I got, like, really offended by it and everything.
Whoa. You need to respect
what Roland Sands is doing. Respect the BMW station wagon.
During the Honda presentation, I forget the gentleman's name was presenting, but he actually claimed that the SR400 was his favorite bike in the lineup.
You mean the Yamaha presentation?
Oh, Yamaha. That's what I meant.
I remember him saying
that. That would have been his last day.
Although I did have... I talked to one of the guys who was leading the demo rides at Honda, And afterwards, you know, we're just chatting, we're talking, and I asked him what he rode, and he kind of out of the side of his mouth, he goes, a GS.
Did you ask the one guy how come he kept getting on the MN04?
Like the no, I didn't.
Yeah, I'm like, why would you ride that bike?
That was it. Was that the Batman bike? Yeah.
We actually opened one of the side cases. It's this big. Like, you can hold a sandwich.
Yeah.
You can put a sandwich in there.
Actually, that's what that same dude. It was the guy. Remember when I first saw you there? You were talking to the bald guy.
Yeah.
Right. It was that guy.
Yeah.
And we're talking about the MN04, and he walks over and pops that open, and he goes, did you see the sandwich storage? Don't tell me.
Is that gone bad?
What's it? I gotta know what's the deal with this. That was like your special little treat that you were saving.
I've never seen this. It's Malta Goya.
Yeah,
that's not beer.
It's not beer.
It's a soda. Like,
yeah, so Goya is like the Mexican food brand. Yeah. If it's Goya, it has to be good. That's their motto. Mm-hmm. It's what it says on the can or on the.
Well, that was Goya. It has to be good.
It doesn't say that on this thing because that is not good.
Well, I'll tell you right there.
Splenda.
Yeah.
It needs more.
No, no.
Because
no, Splenda tastes like dog butt.
Yeah,
that's where taste was.
This is you want to try this?
No.
This is terrible. You want some?
Yeah. You know what? The word's malta.
Sour milk. Here, have a sip.
Here, just smell it.
No thanks.
Oh, come on.
Okay.
It smells like ass. I'm sorry.
Okay.
All right. Endorsement. Yeah, rousing endorsement.
So we were all kind of like talking yesterday. What was? I know you were stuck in the booth for 2 days, but what was like the best thing that you had happen, or saw, or talked about?
She's gonna be like, "Have you seen our new?"
Actually, what was the best thing? I really was kind of stuck in the booth for most of the couple of days talking to people.
Did you get to walk around at all?
Not
Eric
yet.
Eric let you out of the cage at all?
No, but I think tomorrow we're kind of all going to take turns walking the show. Right. Today, the last couple of days, I really was working. I mean, this was about media, about getting things done. But I think. I mean, one of the most fun things, like, makes it really easy, what I do, is, like, we sell the best toys. Like, there's nothing fake about what I have to say or do. I mean, I gave a presentation today on the new SW Motec Trax Adventure aluminum pannier system.
Oh, yeah.
Available now.
Twisted Throttle.com.
But actually, the fun thing is, like, I'm doing this presentation, I'm up on stage, and I'm, like, pulling out some of the camping equipment and the bags and stuff, and I sit down on this camp stool, and I seriously made myself like want to go camping. Like,
you looked like you're having a good time up there.
I actually really was, and that's it. Made like kind of hit me in that moment. Like, this is it made me want to go ride because I'm actually enjoying what I'm talking about.
So that begs the question: what kind of bike do you got?
Well, when I moved out here from California in May, and I sold the bike that I had at the time.
Mm-hmm.
I had a Honda 919, and
great bike.
You know what?
Great bike.
It's my second Honda. I gotta admit, like, the thing about Hondas is they tend to not have a ton of personality to them, but that particular bike, I could ride really well.
Why does everybody say that?
Because it's true.
Yeah, like I said,
they're amazing, like incredibly well designed machines.
Riding my ST1300 was like riding a vanilla ice cream cone.
Yeah. But the 919 is awesome.
919 is great.
That's
got
me
into riding.
And
the
one
place
I had, like, the guy, I bought it used, and the guy had set it up beautifully. So it was a kick-ass bike, and I rode it well. It, like, fit me. But I didn't want to ship it out from California. So I'm trying to figure out what to buy. Because in the meantime, we have a whole bunch of bikes at Twisted. Like, so I mainly ride the, we have a Street Triple R and a 690 SM.
So Eric was talking a while ago about doing a rental fleet. Are you guys doing that?
We just shut it down, I think, for the winter season.
Okay.
But we do have a rental fleet. So, you know, there's a NC700, some GSs.
You guys built, like, a cafe, too, didn't you? Out there?
There was a Triumph Bonneville.
A TT100.
The TT100.
No, no. I'm talking about an actual, you had a restaurant.
Oh, like a cafe.
Oh, you mean a cafe. Yeah.
Place with sandwiches to put in your MN04.
Yeah, you know, the funny thing is the building that we're in, the entire space we occupy used to be like a shopping mall, basically. Like, it was a strip mall.
Right.
And we took over the entire thing. So there's a full restaurant in it at one point, like a restaurant kitchen. And they turned so we have the showroom, and then there's like a cafe part of it, and the restaurant, the kitchen's in the back. The cafe, too, we're coming into, I mean, for those of you that, you know, anywhere but California, like, you have the non-season or the non-riding season, so we've kind of just shut everything down as we're coming into that time where people start parking their bikes.
Where are you?
Exeter, Rhode Island.
Okay.
So it's starting to get a little chilly.
Yeah.
Remember at one point, Eric was talking about doing some kind of operation on the West Coast.
Yeah, he was, and I don't know, I think that's still, at least from a shipping perspective, that still makes a lot of sense, at least having a warehouse.
That's still kind of like an idea thing.
Actually, I think you'd like to move forward with at least the warehouse at some point in the near future, because you got it to be competitive. You got to be able to ship from both coasts. But actually, opening a store and having owned a retail store in California and a business in California, it's bloody expensive, and I'm just not sure it's entirely worth it. I mean, you're seeing companies move out of California. Yeah. I think for that reason,
it's come to Seattle.
Oh, you
there
know,
go.
I know.
There you go.
Yeah, I'd be okay with that. There's a good motorcycle scene up there.
Yeah, you'd
yes,
be up there with Turtec and Altrider, and you guys could have parties together.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
You take a TT100 to Backfire Moto.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. There's a bunch of different places around the country that I think are like motorcycle meccas. I mean, Portland's got a really hot scene right now. I know Austin does. And I mean, we sell things for all kinds of bikes. We're definitely an adventure motorcycle company, so being somewhere near where you do adventure riding, like California, would make sense, except they just make that state makes it really hard to do business and make money.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a bummer.
Yeah, they're trying to pay off all their debt, you know, can you blame them?
Yeah.
They're broke.
James, what do you think is your best of show for the AIM Expo this year? And not that room. You sure you don't want to try this?
I'm quite sure. Honestly, the new VFR, the VFR 800.
Oh, the one Honda won't let me ride.
The one Honda, well, they won't let you ride anything.
The one that Honda let get away.
Yeah. They wouldn't let you ride.
They wouldn't let me ride.
Why?
I didn't have gloves and a long sleeve shirt.
Really?
We could have fixed that. You know, like, because there was a truck with a jacket and gloves in it.
This picture's up at all those demo fleet things. It's in the back. It's in the truck.
Yeah. You grow a beard, man. So you don't look like you anymore, and then go.
Maybe grow a beard, get some glasses.
That's a great idea.
Get
right?
Some super cute ugly glasses.
Some cute ugly glasses. I tried to do the beard. I looked really creepy.
And I think it's just your face.
What if you showed up in like a Halloween costume? As long as you were covered.
A clown costume.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just show up at the Honda booth like,
hey,
that would be better.
Actually, as long as
and then they go, MN04? Like, now the Interceptor.
Tell your name.
MN04.
You know, I want to rail on Honda right here real quick, because they have that rule about, you know, you have to have a long sleeve shirt, you have to have gloves, you have to have a helmet.
Mm-hmm.
No exceptions. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, go fuck yourself. Fine. Yamaha, Suzuki, they do not have those rules, but they had loaner equipment if you wanted it.
Yeah.
Helmets, jackets.
Wait, didn't Honda didn't have the stuff?
No, they didn't have anything. They were just like...
Honda's special.
Yeah, Yamaha and Suzuki had helmets and jackets.
Honda's attitude was very much like, go fuck yourself.
Huh.
We're Honda.
We're Honda.
Yeah.
We have the bat bike.
We have the... I'm sorry, James. Please.
But the Interceptor.
Yeah, the Interceptor. The motor in that bike is ridiculous.
It's fantastic. Do you feel the VTEC at all?
Totally. You hit about 6,500 RPM and it uncorks. The noise changes, the vibrations change, the whole character of the bike changes. And then you get it up to about 9,000 RPM and it just gets silly. It's awesome. I rode that the entire demo ride in first and second gear just so I can keep the RPMs up. It was spectacular.
Wow. How fast were you guys going?
We hit...
How fast was James going?
We probably hit 60-ish.
Oh, okay. For the press days, you get a longer ride.
Yeah.
They'll tend to pick areas where they can speed up quicker.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the bonehead move Zero made, too. Like...
Ugh.
Yeah.
This is, you know, there's a whole purpose of having the industry and press go out and ride on these days, especially for dealers too, because they're going to be trying out new bikes. And that way they can talk about them without having to ride the ones that they're getting in the dealership.
Yep.
But for us, it's the only way we can talk about and write about the stuff. So for, and there's no way I would go stand in the cattle line. No, you know, nothing against the people that are coming to actually ride bikes tomorrow, but we've spent the last 2 days kind of working, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to spend time, wasting time where I could be talking to people in a line. And there's no one there.
Well, and every manufacturer's demo fleet, so even if we could get into the demo fleet program, right, they're all on the West Coast. So that's, you know, it's not going to work for us.
Yeah, they had all their beautiful Zero bikes lined up for the last 2 days outside.
But no one there.
No one would talk about it.
That would have been the only bike that I would have ridden in the demo. Like, I didn't ride any other bikes, but that would have been the only one.
Hear that, Zero? Huh. The only bike.
Yeah.
The only bike.
Well, side by side. That's a different side-by-side. Yeah, the side by side. The turboed side by side, I rode the
shit out. After James and I got off the Hondas, the two 15-year-olds come running up from the side by sides going, "You should have seen us in the turbo side by side. We almost flipped it, and they had the flag waving, and they threw us off the track. It was so much fun. Can we go again?"
We're the two 15-year-olds.
Yeah,
we're the 15. Honda was really pushing that side by side thing at their presentation.
The Pioneer.
Any demo rides.
Side by side.
Can Am, side by side.
Turbocharged.
Batshit insane. It's got an oh shit handle built into the center console that's mounted to the frame for the passenger.
And that's how I judged every side by side after that I saw. I was like, well, what does the oh shit handle look like? No, no. That thing's not crazy enough, because this thing had like an oh shit handle that was like, had like a rosary hanging off of it and shit, you know? Like, I'm like, yeah, that's good.
And there's a whole
oh
shit bar in the front too, so you can get that. It's serious.
Yeah, I mean, Honda was pushing theirs really hard at their presentation, their side-by-side thing. And, you know, they're like, this, it's awesome. And here's all the different models we make of the side-by-side. They're really cool. And, oh, by the way, here's a bike.
Well, Kawasaki, that was the first thing they rolled out.
Yeah.
It was the diesel side-by-side.
Yeah.
But before they tried to knock the booth over.
Yeah. Exactly.
Crash it on the way
well,
back.
Well, it was funny, too. They fired it up. Yeah. And the guy's, like, sitting there, like, full helmet and goggles. And they pull forward like 5 feet, and he's still just like sitting there. And it's like running, and he's like, "Okay, you can turn it on."
I don't know how.
Yeah, I was sitting on a stop either.
Well, and he's, you know, he's got that helmet on with the peak and the tinted visor, and he's turned around looking
at the black curtain
before he backed it up. Right, yeah. Black curtain behind him in a dark area. You know, we couldn't see a damn thing.
No.
Everything's cool. Right? What could go wrong?
Yeah. Only got to move it 5 feet.
Did you happen to watch that?
No, I'm sorry that
it was terrible. It was all the press people first thing in the morning on the first day just ridiculing. Oh,
the best part was that poster, though.
Oh, man. They had a poster on the wall. It had like this plastic like cover on it, so you couldn't see it before they like unveiled it. Well, it was like all sticky, and the guys are like trying to pull this thing off, and they almost ripped this whole poster off the wall.
Oh, no. Yeah, the poster like slipped up and pop off the frame that's holding it on the wall.
And the president of Kawasaki Heavy Industries is in attendance from Japan. CAA.
He's standing there. Yeah.
He's just like.
I've had enough.
tiny little dude in a suit, just nodding.
The best was the videos are playing, and there's no. We talked about the shows. There's no sound at all.
Yeah.
And the press cadre is in the middle of the room going. Brum.
Yeah, I mean, it started by one of the like premier motorcycle magazines editors.
Just say it, Mark Cook.
Yeah, Mark Cook. He's the first one going. Brum, brum.
So at that point, the Kawasaki's guys just thinking that all these round guys are fired.
What do you want to bet they're back in the theater next year?
They had some. The product was kind of cool, except for the Vulcan. But other than that,
oh, you mean their new cafe?
The new cafe,
the Nescafe.
The Nescafe, yeah.
What don't you guys like about
it? It's not a cafe.
It's not a cafe.
It looks like a cruiser.
It's a cruiser with a cafe
what
stripe.
What did they say? The cafe,
it's a
cafe stripe?
It's got a cafe stripe.
And a fly screen.
Stick fly screen on it.
Put a bird on it.
That's all it takes. That's cafe.
That's it.
So like somewhere a hipster's like, what? I'm gonna have
no,
it.
No, Portlandia.
Portlandia.
about hipsters. The way to make anything hipster is to put a bird on it.
Yeah.
Apparently the way to make anything cafe is to put a stripe or a fly screen.
Dude, my mind went was like, you were trying to be all like Brit cool, like put a bird, like put a lady friend back there, you know.
Way to overthink it and well, nice,
right?
Nice.
Think about training.
These guys are speaking hipster right now. It's really hard to follow.
Twisted Throttle lady. Why a surfboard on a motorcycle?
Oh, because that's how you get it to the beach.
Oh, see?
He's got a C3 he wants to put a surfboard on.
Absolutely. If I could get one of those things in my C3, I'd do it in a heartbeat.
Oh, my gosh.
Man, that
thing's what better way?
I'm just angry they didn't put a mount on it a Unimog. Or, I mean, not a Unimog. Hack.
Side car.
I was going to say, if you're carrying a Unimog on the side of your
motorcycle. I know. I just have a fleet of surfboards on my Unimog.
With my sidecar rig, I've already got like a little alleyway there. I can just stick the surfboard and jam it in there. I'm not worried about the wind coming along and launching me into traffic.
Look, it's for when you run out of gas, you hoist your sail up, you start tacking into the wind.
Oh, my God, the sailor.
Twisted Throttle should have been different, though, and put a bicycle on the side of the bike instead of...
Oh, that's been done.
Or BMW does that.
There's a company that makes a bicycle rack.
Put a Grom on it.
If you want to be ridiculous, like just balls out ridiculous, there's bicycle mounts for surfboards.
Mm-hmm.
So you get put a bicycle on the Suzuki.
Surfboard?
Like, I mean, it holds the surboard on the bicycle.
Oh, you need a surfboard mount for a bicycle.
You put the bicycle on the
motorcycle.
Bike
and
the
surfboard on the
it's
bicycle.
It's a turducken. It's a turducken.
You get your motorcycle, you put the Grom with the bicycle, with the Razor scooter.
Yeah.
And one roller skate on the outside.
That's your outrigger. Yeah. Just touches down.
Well, I mean, you know, God, if you tell these guys, like, they'll do it. We have a machine shop just for doing these.
Oh, send it. All right,
next year.
Come up with, so, like, I like the Grom. But I also kind of like the stacking into, like, the flea on the nose and the elephant, or the tail.
Rim,
you know what I mean? Like,
instead of the tub, put a Grom. You just launch the Grom right off it on a ramp.
Well, it's like the Batman bike from the 60s TV show, right?
Yeah, with Robin
and his little...
Yeah.
It would be that I would like to see, because I guarantee you won't see three of them on the floor like you saw with the surfboards,
which was kind of ridiculous, wasn't it? It was like
I don't understand.
And then it's pretty interesting combination, like interesting, like that. It all of a sudden there was like
why
did everyone
think
that?
Yeah,
at the same time, kind of like all those movies that come out.
Yeah, exactly.
Armageddon.
Because there was that
issue of Motorcyclists or whatever where they had the 1200 GS. And the big 1190 or 990 or something KTM, where they went down to Baja and they had the surfboards and they were fulfilling this dream. And I swear after that I started popping up places, and then like the culmination was all of them here at this convention.
I've been seeing a lot of bicycles and surfboards, but it's because I live in San Diego. Mm-hmm.
Maybe the Grom helped kick that off a little bit too, because you know Grom is a name for like a young surfer.
Yep.
So when I went to the intro for that, when Honda first brought it to the US, they did the whole Grand Prix at Honda headquarters and stuff, and that was kind of part of like a story of it. And I remember like even when we were out there on the road, some young surf a guy with a surfboard stopped us, hey, sweet bike, and we're like, dude, this is for you, this is who it's for.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe that kind of, I mean, you see that in California. You see surfboards all the time on bicycles and stuff. Mm-hmm. And so
Honda really tried to make that connection, though.
They did. Yeah.
I'm picturing a
I'm surprised, actually.
Surfboard.
That's a
like a longboard.
Well, I mean, it's part of the packaging. Like, we, you know, the kinds of materials they gave us at this press intro, like, the things they gave us actually had to do with that surf culture, believe it or not. That's... Because it's a bike aimed at young people.
Yeah.
And but it's a dark that looks so appealing.
The foam on that.
You know, you don't have to feel obligated to finish.
Really?
This.
No. I gotta try it. I need to try it.
I'm gonna smell it.
Oh, holy hell!
Right.
Oh.
Right, it kind of smells like
multi-glade light. This is. I've only seen this in Florida. That's why I had to try it.
Oh dear, sweet! It's like drinking
molasses.
It's like drinking molasses.
That's what
and
it smells
licorice.
Like.
Really? Is that what molasses smells like?
Yep.
It does.
Oh. God.
Right?
That's horrible.
It smells...
It's like liquid dirt, man.
You want to try it?
Absolutely.
It's like,
do you like
it
licorice?
It makes me think of yeast.
No, I kind of like licorice. Is that what this tastes like?
Yeah, drink it. It's not. Go ahead. No, it's fine.
Not at all. Good. Not even a little bit.
Yeah.
You can do it.
It's really good, Justin.
Chuck,
come on.
Chuck.
You can do it.
Do it for Twisted Throttle.
Do you
can say it. She's all like, shit.
Good. Do you kind
of
like it?
Lauren? Yeah. Wow.
Oh my god.
It's a glass of dirt water.
Someone has to like it.
That's like,
wait, have you had Moxie?
Oh my god, not in a really long time.
Okay, because it's from Maine. Moxie? It's the first soda marketed in the United States.
So long.
And
yeah.
It tastes crazy. And I know this isn't the soda podcast, but it's like
crazy.
Like, it's got this weird root in it, and it's super old. It's older than, like, it's one of the oldest sodas in the United States. Anyway, you either love it or you hate it.
Does it have the down south root
in it? No.
The down south root?
I actually like it if it's really cold. But it has a funky aftertaste if it's not super cold.
If this were a little more chilled, you guys would all feel different about it.
I think
it's a little
higher temperature right now.
It's been in the fridge for like 2 days.
I think so too, but yeah, just the intensity of the flavor makes me think of Moxie.
Yeah, I can see that. It doesn't taste that cold though.
Maybe it's just really thick and it took a long time to cool down.
I don't know.
But the look on your face was great. It was
this
surprise.
It was this, oh shit, I kind of like this. What am I going to do?
How do I admit this?
I can't.
I have a problem. I'm shocked because, man, that's
yeah, because the look on your face when you first tasted it was one of utter, complete like disgust and horror.
It was like a mouthful of yeast, and not in a good way.
Yeah.
What were we talking about?
Sweet, I'm feeling really good.
Some motorcycle or something.
Your choices on
so, yeah, ground
okay.
surfing. Yeah,
yeah, ground surfing.
So you really like the side by side.
Yeah.
You really like the Interceptor. Did you ride?
Yeah, I think out of everything was the FJ09.
Yeah,
the FJ09 was really cool. Now James wasn't a big fan of it.
I'm not a big fan.
James
of it.
James likes the naked version.
My problem. Now the FJ09. Is a fine motorcycle. I mean, it does what it's intended to do perfectly well. My problem with it is the FZ09 exists, right? So I see how good it could be. The FJ09, to me, feels like the FZ09's slightly frumpy older sister.
But isn't it the same exact power plant?
It's the same exact power plant, but they put the pegs in the wrong place and those bars are too damn wide. And it completely changes the character of the bike to me.
And that was
and the seat feels higher.
You could change the bars.
Yeah,
back to an FZ09.
But it's. I mean, I'm not.
Really, what they gotta do is offer the badge for the FZ09.
No, what they need to do is offer the FZ09 with ABS.
Yeah.
If they did that.
Right.
Problem solved.
Right.
That's my complaint.
That's what I don't get though about
the
manufacturers is why don't you just put it on everything?
Right.
BMW did. You can't buy a BMW. It doesn't have ABS anymore.
Yamaha USA is they have some bizarre fear of ABS. In Europe, you can get it with. Not here.
In Europe, isn't it ABS standard? Has to be standard.
I don't think it's mandated.
I thought it was.
I'm still shocked that motor isn't in more bikes.
I agree.
Just the FZ, the FJ, it should be.
It should be in everything Yamaha makes.
There should
that
be
motor is so good.
In the TW200.
Yes.
Yes. With
that
A mode.
That would be awesome.
They need a grand
with those big fat tires.
With the triple in it.
There you go.
I would gladly put two surfboards on that bike,
and then you'd fly.
They would be great. Yeah, to deploy them. But no, that motor is so awesome.
The motor's fantastic. Like I said, the FJ09 is a great bike for what it is. I just like the FZ so much better, and frankly, I'm a little pissed that I can't get it with ABS. That's my problem.
If they had it, you'd buy it, right?
If I could get the FZ09 with ABS, there would be one in my garage right now.
Yeah, it's a great bike. I mean, I like the motor on it, and I like it in A mode personally.
Yeah.
I liked it better than the Versus 1000. I was not a huge fan of that one.
Yeah, I haven't ridden the FZ yet, so.
That's how I felt when I rode the V-Strom. When we were here last year, when I rode the new V-Strom, I was like, man, it's boring.
Yeah, I've never been a big fan of the V-Strom.
The V-Strom, the 1000?
When they came out with the new version with the beak.
Yeah.
You know,
I feel like the V-Strom's like that soda you were talking about. People either like really love it or they...
The 1000 just kind of feels super squishy to me.
Yeah.
It's the brakes weren't great. The suspension wasn't passable as far as I was concerned, which again, disappointing because the 650 is so good. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I could not come to terms with 1000 at all.
The Versus is kind of Hyundai-y. It's just, yeah. It's very proficient in doing what it does. It's totally like my 650 Versus. Just has a lot more punch to it. Mm-hmm. And it's wider, obviously. It's bigger. But, you know, I was riding that, and after a couple minutes, I forget I'm on a 1000. I felt like I was back on my old Versus.
So your Versus was the first gen, right?
It was a second.
Oh, it was?
It was a second. It didn't have the Punisher headlight.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just can't do boring bikes anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, the same thing with that CB1100 that I rode yesterday. Mm-hmm. It was just like, it's boring. You know, it was smooth. It was really great, but there's no character on it, you know? And then the NC700X was just,
well,
it was, that would have been a great bike to own without the DCT. Mm-hmm. As a commuter bike,
yep.
You know, around town.
The DCT is just so miserable.
Especially in, the D is useless.
Completely.
Completely useless. No, it seriously is.
1800 RPM. The shift point is 1800 RPM.
Could you say that again? The what?
I'm not saying
that. You know what you just made me think about, though? Is that, I almost feel like we're splitting hairs a little bit, because really, realistically, like, you know, I've ridden a lot of these bikes. They're still pretty easy to ride. I mean, they're going to get you where you need to go. You can still have fun on it.
They're all good bikes.
They're all mm-hmm. good bikes.
I'm not saying they're not. I'm just saying they're boring.
But what's fun? Here. Exactly.
That's all you do.
Yeah.
I know, but what's funny, it reminds me of... So a couple of bikes I rode recently that were really like... That really struck me in a way that was totally different than anything I'd ridden in a while was the Ducati Scrambler and the Yamaha Bolt. And I rode the R-Spec and the C-Spec. And the thing about them is, I mean, these are not performance bikes. You know, they're not going to stand up to the bikes we've been talking about. But the Scrambler, when you sit on it, is you have that very, like, classic sort of, like, you know, I was at the intro we did out in Palm Springs, and you can't help but smile. Like, you're riding around, and you have this feeling, like, essence of motorcycling, where you're out there. It's, you can go at a pretty good clip on that thing, but it's not a performance bike, but it's all about how you feel and how you look. And the Bolt, I felt so badass. Like, when I was on the R-Spec, I, riding around town, like, for the first time in a long time, I was like, I look cool. Like, people looking at me think I look good. And I felt like Sons of Anarchy. And but actually, the funny thing is, like...
And you should have a sports star.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, that if you're...
But, you know, I would have one in my, if I could have a fleet of bikes.
Right,
right.
I would have one because, it comes to, like, your point about the FJ versus the FZ09. Mm-hmm. I'm more of a sport bike kind of badass, you know, Street Fighter type person. So yeah, I don't see myself on the FJ, but if I really were being practical about it, and if I wanted like one bike to do everything, to do my long trips, to do my around town, whatever, to go to the canyons, maybe it would be the FJ just because you have wind protection. But if I want to feel good and if I want to have fun, I would. So we're actually like, we're picking the bikes that make our heart beat or maybe make us feel like the person we want to be like the rider you want to most exhibit to the world.
Yeah.
That's how you choose this bike.
Because I mean, looking at it objectively, there are very few bad motorcycles right now. Right? I mean, it's pretty hard to buy a bad motorcycle.
Yeah.
So, like, especially, you know, Buick Ulysses.
Oh, best bike ever made.
Yeah. The Duratec guy.
I tried. That's the greatest reaction to somebody.
I love that,
like, the biggest smile I've seen. Guy.
No, it's kind of like.
Oh, you're special.
That's cute. You know, like, that was that.
I'm just like, I'm sorry.
If you had said, "Aw, honey," or "Bless your heart." Aw, honey.
That's
true. That's a lot of your logo. You try.
But you're pretty on the inside.
You know, the most fun I had riding today was on the Can-Am F3. That three-wheeler.
That's the new one, right?
The new one.
The performance
they're
one?
The cruiser. One. It's a cruiser.
The
forward deal.
Yeah.
Man, I can't ride a cruiser on two-wheeler. How am I going to ride one on three?
You know, it's weird. On that Can-Am Spider, that foot forward position
felt normal.
Everything felt normal. I felt like I was riding a quad.
Right.
But it was still like big old smile, music's blaring at me. And I'm like,
oh. That was funny because, like, she was talking about the C-Spec and the R-Spec. I rode them both, and I liked the C-Spec better. Just because
I was more comfortable in that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I like it better overall, mm-hmm. but I felt badass on ours. But
the Bolt's a cool little bike.
The Bolt's a great bike.
Yeah.
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 Really, I mean, great.
Not so great bikes. The Street.
Oh yeah,
we rode that last year. It was.
Yeah.
It'd be a shame. Take that motor and put it in something. The chassis is horrible.
That's exactly it. It's a fantastic motor.
Yeah.
Chassis. Bad Harley copy of a Harley.
Yeah.
Well,
I actually thought it was a bad Harley copy of a Japanese bike.
That's
was
exactly
the,
it's,
the irony of it all. Yeah.
I guess the idea was to drag newer riders into the dealership that might not have been able to afford. Yeah. You know, with the loss of Buell's Blast, I think, because that was kind of an entry level bike for a lot of people.
That was their trainer bike, but they never pushed it too hard.
No, but I think there were people that actually, like, especially in an MSF course, they got on that bike and were kind of afraid of anything bigger and went, I like this, you know? I'm going to go out and buy it. Because didn't they use GS250s for a while too, the Suzukis for the trainers? Yeah, some of them did.
Huh, I didn't hear that.
Not the Harley ones, but like the Palm Beach that we had, MSF.
Yeah. MSF,
yeah. So I don't know. I think the bike maybe has a market, has a place, but it's just.
It's confusing. The Street models are confusing. I mean, if you're looking to bring entry level riders in and then have them graduate to Harley's bigger bikes, it's nothing like it. Mm. I mean, the turn signals aren't in the right place.
Yeah, they're right. Like your standard turn signals.
Right, exactly. Right. It's a Japanese designed bike.
Yeah.
So none of that carries over. It just doesn't work.
It sounds like a car.
Then their sales force just doesn't know what to do with it.
Well, it's Buell all over again in that regard. Right?
Yeah, like you come in and they're like...
Oh, you mean that thing in the corner?
Like, what?
Right.
What?
You don't want that.
That one or
that guy?
Yeah.
You don't want
that. It's in the window to get you in the door, but it's far too shitty for you to buy.
It's actually just 3D printed.
So. You know, a 3D printed bike would probably be better than what that thing is. It's...
Like I said, the motor's kind of cool. Take that motor and put it in the Livewire chassis.
That's exactly it. Okay. That's what I've been saying since I rode the Livewire.
Yeah. Okay. Put that motor in the Livewire chassis.
Yeah.
That thing would be kick ass.
Yeah.
The Can-Am Cruiser felt more like a Harley to me than the Street did.
Whoa.
It just got real. So he rode a Harley truck today. That's not a factory truck though, right?
Harley's building factory trike.
They are.
Like a Harley trike. I mean, the model name was Freewheeler. I didn't look it up, but I don't know.
That's a Harley name.
They're the only company, right? That's building a trike as an OEM manufacturer.
I thought
nobody else is.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. This trip out, I was really into three wheels because, you know, I've got my sidecar rig. I'm always jumping around.
That's like what I asked you today. Is it the same kind of feeling? Like looking at a Ural, I just want one.
The Harley trike felt kind of like a Ural in a lot of ways. You know, you gotta have that spatial awareness that you're a lot fatter. You turn
sharp on a trike. Can you lift a wheel on it or not in the back?
I didn't get it.
Sure, you can.
You probably don't want could. To.
No, I'm just saying. I'm not saying on purpose, but the same dynamic like flying the car.
It feels a lot different.
Well, you'd end up doing this.
Right.
Yeah.
You tip that way.
You tip forward.
Sounds like a really bad idea.
But, you know, I was moving my body around on a bike and turning the same way I would with a Euro. And Harley was the only one whose demo route took you onto the freeway. And they would go out and do like the
Ford. We got to go on the freeway in the EBR, though.
That's true.
Yeah.
Last year, when Chuck was not there.
That is low.
I got going like 110, like right.
And fuck you in particular, good sir.
And the Buell you rode in on.
Yeah, the Freewheelers are the factory.
Now, here are
the
Freewheelers.
Yeah, okay. 2016, $25,000,
$26,000. Yeah.
It was a nice. You know, if you wanted a three-wheel bike, it was nice.
What was the base on it? Like a Ultra Classic or a...
I wasn't sure. It looked kind of like a Glide of some sort.
Yeah. Hmm. That's a cool
bike. They all look alike to me. I don't know.
They also have the Tri-Glide, which I think is based on the bigger touring bike.
That was the video I had to watch. I had to watch a separate safety video about the three-wheeler before we were doing it.
Did Honda have a safety video you had to watch too? Uh-huh. Because they had a screen, I didn't know. Did you watch a safety video?
For the three-wheeler.
Oh.
For the three-wheeler. There was additional paperwork.
Like, they couldn't just have a guy go, hey, numbnuts.
No,
not a two-wheeled vehicle.
They had that, too.
You got do this.
They had that too. Oh. They made me watch a safety video. They put me through an orientation.
Shouldn't you just show them a picture of you riding the Ural and go, look, I get it?
Well, I kept saying, they were like, you know, you don't steer this the way you do a bike. I understand, I have a Ural. And you don't lean this thing like you do a bike. I understand, I have a Ural.
Also, I can see it and I understand physics.
Well, but it's me.
Point taken.
You're Japanese, you're good at math.
Just all these things.
You just said he was Chinese.
All these things. Finally, fuck you, I have a Ural. The Can-Am was pretty cool as in that
regard. I think it's badass.
It was fun. I had a lot of fun on that thing.
I'm not that old yet.
That's kind of my reaction.
Yeah. It's seriously? Get the fuck out.
I asked somebody at work the other day, he's a hardcore Harley guy that I work with, and I said, you know, when you get old, because I'm always giving him shit about how old he is, and he's just about to retire, and I'm like, so when you get too old to ride your huge, he has like a geezer glide or whatever.
And, couch glide.
Yeah, the couch glide. And I'm like, so when you can't hold that thing up anymore, are you going to go to the three-wheeler? Or are you hanging it up? He goes, oh, I'm fucking hanging it up. And he's like a hardcore Harley guy, so I don't know.
He could get the Goldwing.
And then there's like, it's all those like theoretical questions like, okay, if you lost a leg, would you try to modify? Like, what are you doing? Or are you going to the trike? He's like, I'm fucking making a contraption, you know? And like,
dude, I don't know. The trike was fun. My dad
has a Goldwing trike.
Yeah, it's, you know, maybe I'm old on the inside. I don't know.
It's completely unlike riding a motorcycle.
It is.
I've ridden a bunch of it. That's just the thing.
It's not riding a motorcycle.
Entirely unlike. Right. Yeah, you can't approach
totally
it like
different.
That.
Totally different.
Yeah. But you still have the outside visceral feeling of being out.
In the wind, smelling the cows.
When I get to that point, you know, if I can no longer support a two-wheeler, I'm just going to get a Miata.
Oh, really?
Yeah. If I can't ride two wheels,
what about a slingshot?
Just get an aerial
a little toe hitch trick.
I know you don't like that thing at all. Have you ridden one yet?
No, I haven't.
Just listen before you make judgments. So go ride one because
ride what?
A slingshot.
Oh,
why,
really?
What's
have
the?
Really
I don't get it.
Yeah, the center of gravity is a lot lower than a car is. They handle like you wouldn't believe. They're lighter than a car.
What, the Can-Am guys?
No, the slingshot.
The slingshot.
Polaris slingshot.
Yeah. Or get a KTM, the crossbow.
What is that?
Big. They don't sell them in the U.S., though, do they?
Who cares?
Well, then how are you going to get it?
Import
Canada?
It.
Mexico. Is the slingshot considered a car? Or a
depends on what state you're in.
You have to wear a helmet.
You have to wear a helmet.
Not in Florida, you don't.
Well, in Florida, you don't have to wear a helmet on anything.
Yeah, but it's registered. Well, it's still registered as a bike. That's right. You just have to pay a certain amount of liability insurance. If you're
is the slingshot three wheels?
Two in the front, one in the back. Yeah. Two, but it's a side by side. It's a double seat.
Yeah.
Oh,
it's a side by side. I bet it has no shit handle.
The question is, how good is that ocean handle? How robust? What does it feel like when you sit down in it? When you sit down in a car or side by side, you say, there's no oh shit handle here. You're like, I must not need to grab onto anything, you know? Like, this had like a substantial.
Yeah, it was a big stick with like finger indentations.
It was like ergonomic for your hand. Yeah. It clearly meant for when he was driving for me to just hold on.
There's blood dripping off.
It's like fingernails.
Because I had a camera in each hand, so I'm just like.
Yeah, by the way, too, that video you guys shot was a really cool video of the dash.
We were both just like little kids, though. Like, you said, like, go faster!
And you hear a crash. Is there memory in this camera?
You guys can't remotely record this, can you? Like, you can't, like, look on your phone and, like, see what I was, like, doing the camera, right?
I mean, I spent, like, an hour alone in my bedroom, but you guys don't know what I'm doing.
Yeah. Hey, what color pants was I wearing? Or not wearing?
Crash! We got it, Crash! Jesus can see you! Not him I'm worried about.
On the video, though, I hear you guys going, like, we're going to run over the flag. Yeah, fuck all those flags. We're going to run them over.
He's
Is that why they that could have been why they were whistling at us.
They have corner workers that, like, on around the track for the side by side and ATVs, have like flags and whistles to tell you to slow the hell down. And we got blown whistles by every single one of them on every corner.
So you weren't slowing down.
So yeah.
No, we slowed down. Yeah.
Like one time,
they blew the whistle.
One time to give them the finger.
You didn't. Let's put it this way: you didn't have to hit the brakes going into a corner because you could just goose it and it would walk the end
you
of the.
You just had to hit the gas harder.
You yeah. just had to hit the gas harder.
That's
and
always
just,
the answer,
it turned
right? More
it.
Throttle.
Go faster.
Yeah. More try to explain power. That to people riding in gravel really fast on a motorcycle.
That's just how it works with the Euro. Faster. You just give it more power in a corner.
And if you don't give it enough power, then you figure that out really quickly. You get launched off.
Yeah, Euro, you just stop.
Yeah.
You just have to have a good monkey in the sidecar and you're okay.
Yeah.
That's so much fun.
Without the monkey, though, what's it like?
Left turns are great.
I know, you told me right turns are bad.
Just,
you can just drift everywhere on left turn. Right turns, you get a little light and you feel a little weird unless you're intending to fly the car around like that.
Right.
But yeah, so you go left everywhere. Just
You alter your route so it's all left.
It's all left. Instead of left.
All right, so if you weren't working, what would you be going to look at? If you weren't working, you didn't have to work, and knowing everything that was there, what would you go to see?
I mean, definitely, I could go see the OEs because I'd like to see all the new models,
right?
You know, and
which
see them
nothing was like super exciting. I thought on new models,
the most interesting new bike was the Cowie, the Z800.
Yeah. They didn't have it outside, though, right?
They did not have it outside.
What power plant was that from? I mean, is that something new for the U.S.?
I think it was new for the U.S.
They said that it was like they just brought it over.
Yeah, but I don't think that motor's in anything else here.
You know, it's funny because, like, everyone's going to this middleweight, and I heard Suzuki's going to dump the GXR 750.
Yeah, I mean, it's the last 750
right.
remaining, right? Kawasaki got rid of theirs a decade ago.
Yeah, but that would be so tragic. Yeah. That leaves a hole. That leaves a real... I had the 750.
Yeah.
It was the perfect in-between bike.
Well,
there's a hole in her heart.
But anymore... I mean, that used to be very true, right? But now, the 1000s have gotten so light and compact, and the 600s have become so powerful that dividing line isn't quite as broad as it used to be.
No, except with the 6, I just felt like you had to rev it so much
yeah.
to keep it in power. It was just too hectic for, like, an everyday kind of city bike, or for me at the time. And the 1000 is just way more power than I'm ever going to need. And I just didn't completely trust myself with that. So the 750 seemed like a nice compromise.
Mm-hmm.
Weren't you on a 919?
Yes, the 750 was a wow. But you know what? That wasn't the same
as. The power. I'm not gonna need that kind of power.
Of an additional 80.
Yes.
Right. But it's not the same as like the GSXR 1000. Like it's not even. You know, that's a whole different animal. So that would be why. But, you know, I was thinking too. If I when I'm walking around tomorrow, somebody I met today was telling me about some guy that created some kind of like tension straps where a piece of it is rubber, so when you are
rock straps, that's a rock strap. They've been on a really long time.
Well, I'm curious, but it's actually like a portion of the length of it. So as you're tensioning it,
yeah, like a rock strap, the one end of it that
for like strapping your stuff down, right?
Yeah, I mean, I had to go see this myself,
that.
So I'm not entirely sure.
It's a rock strap. That's what it is. Part of it is elastic. It's rubber, really, really tight.
It's got loops on both ends.
There's loops on both ends. You kind of girth hitch it on whatever you're going to lock down. The other end is nylon with an adjuster buckle. That's a staple.
Well, I'm curious what this guy, because the thing is to me, like,
Gandalf's working in the booth.
Yeah.
Did you see that?
What? He's at like every event. The guy looks like Gandalf.
I can't wait. This is what I'm going to go see tomorrow.
Gandalf.
Rock
straps.
Yeah.
They're like the cats in us.
I want to see the weird things people come up with. Like, that's actually
this
part
is,
of the fun of these shows, is like somebody thought this was a great
idea.
There's
a lot weirder stuff out there. There was a guy last year, and I tried to find him this year, that actually came up with a tool with like safety wire for creating clamps for hoses.
Oh, yeah, that's an old tool.
That's really kind of cool.
Yeah.
It's just like the length of wires wrapped around there, this tool kind of spins, it pulls it, and it kind of creates a clamp, like a hose clamp.
Yeah, gnarls it all together.
Really, really tight.
Can't do it.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
It's great. You need like a safety wire pliers?
Not really. It's really
like lineman's pliers where you pull the knob.
No, not like a safety wire.
It's, you like thread the thing in there and you just start cranking it.
Because it does it double. It does it like two together, two loops together. So it makes it one time. It makes a clamp.
Yeah.
Which is really nice because all you have to keep like for trips like you're talking about doing, you just have to have this little tool and some wire. And you could fix any type of hose that you broke. You wouldn't have to worry about getting the right size.
I'm taking KTMs and KLRs, so I don't know what problems could arise.
That could be fixed by wire.
Yeah. My positive can-do attitude is going to carry me from Mexico to Canada.
And all the way to Alaska where you'll cry. Yeah. You'll be like,
we're not pushing it to Alaska. We're just going.
Why am I in Alaska?
Oh, yeah.
And then you're taking the safety wire and you're strapping it around your neck. You're
going to see, there's probably like 10 things that are weirder than rock straps that are there today.
Yeah. And that's part of the thing too. Like, I want to see what people invented. So and they're trying to.
10 different helmet companies that you've never heard of?
Yeah.
There's always, for every cool new helmet, there
Did
was
you
like
notice
a.
That? How many helmet companies have? Never heard of before.
Well, it's such a saturated. Why don't they even try to compete? Like that, I don't get.
And there was one helmet company with a big sign that said, "Need an OEM helmet?"
Yeah.
In other words, we'll make it. You can put your sticker on it and sell it under your brand.
Look for the Wheelnerd branded helmets at finer stores near you.
With Chuck's face on the back,
you would trust that.
Oh,
I mean in general.
Yeah,
that's a
sure. Yes.
All right.
What? I mean,
if you're looking for other like unusual things, if you're facing the food area, in terms of that last aisle down the right, there's a bunch of crazy, crazy like art concept bikes.
Oh, those
that look nuts.
With the seats.
But what you need to look at is the two people running the booth. The bikes are crazy. The people running the booth are special.
Really?
Show up for the bikes. Stay for the vendors.
I just remember the one seat that looks like a barbecue grill.
And they're all like knee high.
I was on the phone. I was talking to my girlfriend.
You?
In the lunch area. One of the people running the booth walks by, and I made a few jokes like about a tired looking old booth babe walking by. Yeah. And then later on, I was like, oh man, that's not.
Oh, was it the scary girl? The scary girl.
No. It was scarier than that.
You're thinking of that, the like super like ripped chick.
No, the scary girl with all the tattoos and the.
Oh, with like the short dark hair.
Yes, that scary girl.
No, different.
Different scary girl.
Different. Yeah.
Different. As artificial as the motorcycles.
Oh.
Scary girl.
Okay.
I saw Ripley though.
Yeah, Ripley. Like her back was crazy.
Wow. Yeah.
Did you tell your girlfriend about that?
No, but she just heard.
I'm not kidding. Look under the table because I think
he's been texting.
Yeah. I have. Yeah.
Don't worry. I know. I can see from over here what's going on.
The first 4 minutes of this video were silence, apparently. So it's a good thing we have 15 other recording devices on the table.
Oh wow. Okay. Yeah. This has been recording, so you know. Yay, Wheelnerd's technology. What do you mean you don't trust it?
Good job.
Yeah.
Really, not that it matters. It's live streaming, so we can't go back and fix it.
No.
Right.
Somebody's probably pretty good at like reading lips or
not
something.
Not that you guys needed an update, but this is leaving a really bad taste in my mouth.
That's why you gotta have a chaser with that.
Do you want some ice?
I think I'm over it.
It.
No, I'm good. I'm good. I've had enough.
You had like that much of it, and it's made you sick already. So
it's been developing. It's unpleasant.
I think it's growing. There's something. It's like
there's more of it than there was.
Yeah.
It's coming around.
Yeah. So walking around today, there was. There was really nothing that I saw different from yesterday that really got me super excited.
Not from yesterday. Yeah. I'm still super stoked about that Cena helmet.
Yeah, that's amazing.
That
if they get that, if they kind of, and I know it's a prototype, you know, the helmet is. The only thing about it is you're limited to that one particular design helmet. That's it. But the technology is so good in the noise canceling that I'd go for that.
Yep.
Yeah.
They're pimping it out on their Facebook page today.
Yeah, oh, yeah. All over the place.
Yeah.
Which is kind of funny because it's kind of like not ready for prime time.
Yeah,
so
right.
They got to push it now.
You should
I'm
go
sure
check
like
that out. Go look at it.
Yeah, What's the deal with the
active noise canceling?
Yeah,
built into the helmet.
It's got like headphones.
Yeah, it's got
cups
ear cups
in the helmet, and they work amazing.
Yep, and they sound great.
Yeah,
so
played music.
You already have like a stereo built in, like you've got the headphones.
You can add a Bluetooth module to it,
but it has the noise canceling
already in it.
Yeah. It's just an amazing.
So you can hit a button over here and it gives you ambient noise, and then you hit the button over here and it does the noise canceling.
So if you want to have a conversation,
right,
you could, the mic will pick it up. They're saying 600 to 800. They don't know exactly yet. They're still in the prototype phase.
They didn't say who's making
it. It's 600 to 800 with the noise canceling feature, and then the Bluetooth will be.
Oh,
and you can actually get either technology package, the SMH10 technology for it, or the 20S. So either one will be available.
Yeah, two different levels.
Actually, now that I think about it, the vest was kind of cool that you got blown up on. Yeah,
yeah. I got blown up with one of those crash vests, the Helite vest.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It was pretty cool. That was like the first thing this morning. I like went over there, and these guys were doing like a separate interview, and she was like, yeah, I'm going to explode it. And I don't think she said the word explode, actually. I take that back. But she was like, yeah, we're gonna test it. And I like ran over there. And I was like, I need you to record this.
I want to get blown.
Yeah.
It's super fast. Like, I was...
8 milliseconds.
Yes.
And does it deflate immediately?
No, it starts... It goes fully inflated. And it is a lot of pressure really fast. And you have to be wearing a helmet because it lifted my head up on the helmet. But and then it after like 10 or 15 seconds, it kind of starts releasing a little bit of pressure just so you can actually like breathe again. And and then it's got like a bleed off on the thing.
Yeah.
But then it can be ready for use again in like...
Immediately.
Yeah.
You just like, need a new cartridge.
30 seconds, it comes with the tool, and you reset it yourself. And
there's really no repacking of it or anything. It's just redoing the cartridge, rearming it, and that's it.
And I guess technically, you'd actually want it to stay inflated, because unlike in a car, you're not going to be stopped by something instantly.
Right.
Like, you're going to keep bouncing down the road, so you have to... You need that cushion the whole time.
What do you think would happen if you didn't wear the helmet?
I can find out for you.
Would it punch you in the face?
No, it won't go high enough. I don't think it... I honestly don't think it would do much of anything without the helmet.
It'd probably just blow up right next to your ear.
It's not going to really keep your head in line like with the helmet on.
It's like a safety thing, so you know, like if it exploded.
I mean, with the helmet on, it's like a great neck brace thing. I mean,
it stabilizes your neck really well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to try to get that for our show, and I'm going to like strap it on and then have Todd drive me on the Euro, and I'll like throw myself in the ditch.
You're like, it won't release and just drag you by the
It takes 60 pounds of pressure to trigger.
That's the good thing, because I was thinking, I didn't really think about that. I'm thinking that you'd like stop off at bar number 5, you know, and grab your bike, forgetting to unhook it, and it just... Understand, everybody's laughing at you.
Well, that's when you know you've had enough.
You've had enough.
It was actually funny watching the first time they did it, like, because she like yanked on it and
almost
he just
pulled me
forward.
Over. I was like,
and he wasn't. And he was just like, whoa. And then, like, I kind of have expected her to, like, put her foot against it.
Knock you down to the ground. Hold still.
Quit 60, resisting.
60 pounds is a lot. That's why they had to design that trigger, because all the, like, industry CO2 triggers are nothing like that.
Yeah.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
And it's ready to go.
Yeah, I mean, you and I both deal with those, like, self-deployable jackets. So
I wonder how... There are already, like, air vests or jackets, Dionysius got the airline. I wonder how they're doing. I mean, like, are people lying?
Right, how successful they are.
Yeah.
Well, Dionysius, I think they're using them in the race suits. I mean,
she was saying they're a lot bigger in Europe.
It's a French company. They're importing
they're big in
a
Europe.
French product.
They're big in Europe. They've been around. The
like David Hasselhoff.
Like, like she was saying, like, the technology's been around 15 years in Europe. So
wow.
It's got a following.
Someone's making one in South America, too. I know that, because... I was talking to a guy in Miami, and he's like, "Yeah, we've been looking at these things."
Yeah, but
in South
it fills
America.
With coke.
It's got the white powder from the airbag. It goes everywhere when you inflate it.
You don't feel nothing.
I think it's one of those things. Like, I didn't really think about it before, but now I've seen the product. It's a vest. It goes over whatever jacket you're wearing, or you can buy one of their jackets that has it built in. But I mean, it'll go over any jacket. It doesn't weigh a whole lot. And what's the problem with wearing it? Like, what do you stand to lose by wearing it, really? You know, like,
so if you were going to do like a really rocky pass, would you wear one?
Well, you know, before I went and tried it out today, no, because I didn't really understand it. But now that I know that, like, okay, it's not really going to, I was thinking it would almost harm you if you were wearing it when it went off, mm-hmm. you know, like that's how extreme it was going to be. But now that I know that, no, it's not going to, and it's so easy to reset.
Yeah, so like even
it's really it's different from it's different technology from an airbag will kill you.
Yeah,
if you're not seatbelted in or
well, that's what that's why I was that's why I was kind of afraid of it at first because I was like, how am I going to test this? You know,
because it is you have to think of it like a life preserver, really.
Yeah,
inflatable everything
like a working vest.
It's not going to hurt you, right?
Yeah,
exactly.
Did she tell you about the leather one they're working on?
The what?
The jacket?
A leather vest. They want to make it look like, you know, the Sons of Anarchy leather, black leather vest.
Can you imagine that in a biker bar? The thing goes off by accident. Like,
people are going to be looking for the ripcord and like running around and pulling.
I was telling her, like, you got to make the inner expendable part pink. Yeah. High vis, neon, just.
No, that was actually a really. I know it's been around, the technology, but to actually see it inflated on you like that, too.
Yeah,
that's not bad. That's kind of cool.
James is showing me the
2-in-1.
Okay, I take it back.
Oh, right. Yeah,
they were doing
that. I completely take it back now.
That your was best in shows. Yeah.
That was the coolest thing I've seen.
The 2-in-1.
Go take a look at the Schubert's held booth.
Tell her, James, because you kind of like...
Yeah.
So the 2-in-1 jacket, it's one of those things you look at it and you're like, why has this not happened before? Right? 100 years of motorcycling history and we've just gotten to this point. So it's a jacket that you put it on like any normal jacket and it's perforated and vented and you've got a great summer jacket. There's a liner built into it though. The thing is the liner never comes out. Right? You don't have to zip it in. When it's in that mode, the liner is just the back of the jacket.
Yeah, it's like folded up against the back.
Right. So if you need the waterproof portion, you just unzip that, and there are a couple snaps that attach, and you put your arms through holes that are in the liner rather than in front of the liner.
Right.
And now you've got a waterproof jacket.
They have gloves the same
right?
way.
I mean,
so, gloves and pants.
So if I had like you know glove liners like. Stick a pair of glove liners in a pair of gloves and then pull your hand out of both.
Right.
And then stick your hand between the glove liner and the glove and stick it in there. That's
it works
what it's like.
Seamlessly.
But yeah. Except the glove liner is built into the glove.
It doesn't
so
feel
you just
bulky.
Have the option.
Yeah, you've got two different slots. Yeah.
You don't feel any extra bulk.
It on top of the liner, the glove's ventilated. It's a summer glove. It starts raining, pull your hand out, put it back in, and now you've got a waterproof glove.
Well, I mean, but you couldn't do this with, like, a thermal liner. Like, it's pretty much, you're getting...
It's a Gore-Tex.
Because it has to be something thin, right? Yeah. Otherwise, it wouldn't really work.
They do have a winter version, which has a little more bulk to it.
Huh.
Yeah, they have a winter version, a three-season version. And a
you don't really feel it, either. It's not like you're feeling any type of extra material.
Yeah, that's
what I'm
it's extremely
yeah.
well done.
Because the one thing I noticed, you know, when I had the retail store, and I sold used gear, is I got a lot of jackets missing liners. Mm-hmm. Because, especially in California, everybody just takes them out and tosses them. They never wear them.
Exactly.
And also because they're uncomfortable. And any, like, the jackets that I have, that especially if they have, like, a waterproof and a thermal, I almost never wear the thermal liner because it's thick, and my own base layer will be a lot more comfortable. Yeah.
And they're just a pain in the ass.
It's a pain in the butt. Yeah, to like have to take it out, unsnap the cuffs.
I can't tell you how many times I forgot my rain liners.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you a wool base layer person? The performance wool?
Yes. Yeah.
I started to switch that, actually. I like it. Merino wool.
Yep.
The more I've learned about it and tried it and used it, like when I went to Overland Expo, I had
base weird memories from Christy talking about you and her came back, and that's why Christy Farrell.
Wool, yeah.
Yeah, because she wears the same stuff, and she was like, "Yeah, Jess broke up," and that's why when you talked when you said your own base layer, I was like, "Oh, she's got to be talking about that wool stuff."
Yeah, but I don't remember anything.
Have you ever tried it?
No.
Oh, they're great!
Yeah, you live in California.
Yeah.
I was thinking about it. Like that's all I have.
Yeah.
Once you get into it, it's kind of hard to stop.
Yeah.
Crisco. I like Crisco.
Basically. Yeah. Slather yourself in a nice layer of fat.
Icebreakers or whatever. Yeah.
That's what I have. The icebreakers, yeah.
Yeah.
I bought them before we went out to Overland Expo, and they were phenomenal. That and low-print wool socks were really good. Because the stuff dries quick, too.
Yeah.
Smart wool, man.
Huh?
Yeah.
Smart wool.
Yeah, smart wool.
Yeah.
Have you had a chance to go to IMS shows as well?
I will this year. No, it's not, when I had the retail store, it was hard to do any of that stuff. Mm-hmm. But now that I'm at Twisted Throttle, I will be going to the IMS.
I was kind of curious if you guys, if Twisted Throttle or you guys, you personally had like an opinion of IMS versus the AIM Expo.
Well, since it's my first AIM, it's hard to say because I feel they really serve different markets.
IMS is different from region to region too. The Miami show is horrible.
Yeah.
And well, Long Beach is a whole different animal from the rest of them.
Long Beach and New York are like the only two that have press days.
Well, New York. New York is just a consumer show.
Yeah.
Well, that's what Miami was like, taking the Harley thing from Bike Week and putting it in the convention center down there. That's all it was. It was like biker stuff.
Yeah. AIM feels more polished to me. It feels, because the local shows are colored by like their location, by the quality of the vendors you get.
Fat dudes wearing leather vests.
Yeah, the people. The people you're shoving your way through to get to see stuff. Whereas AIM has a professional, clean, you know, nice, stepped up kind of feel.
We'll see how you feel tomorrow.
Tomorrow's going to be
Generation Day.
I agree, but the booths look good. I mean, I will say especially in the way they have like a contest for best design booth. I mean, they try and challenge the vendors to make it look good.
Is Kawasaki eligible for that? No, I mean, their booth is phenomenal.
It looks great. Their booth looks, as long as it doesn't have to work.
What did he say, though? What did he say about, great, like, go get the stuff and go look at it in the corner? And you kept telling, he's like, the booth's a circle. What corner is he talking about? He kept referencing something in the corner.
Yeah, like in the corner over there. I'm like,
hey, when I went down, when we left the keynote thing, I went downstairs to drop off the tickets at the will call. There was actually people that were showing up at the media registration, like arguing, saying that today was supposed to be for the public.
Yeah,
they were getting pissed off.
People were getting pissed at me. They kept asking on the Instagram. I was posting pictures of shit all day yesterday. They were like, "How'd you get in?"
I don't know. I just walked in.
I just walked in, man. And it was like, I'm in Orlando. What happened?
The parking lady gave me a hard time about it. She was just like, "This is media exhibitor." Blah, blah, blah.
We didn't know.
We had special media parking.
Special media parking.
You.
They only let the coolest people know about that.
We just like a big lot, right?
In like a loading zone.
Media. It says authorized media. We're authorized media. I parked there.
Yeah.
And nobody said anything.
No pass in the dash. No tag.
Nobody had that.
Really?
No one did. Nobody did.
Next year, I'm making one on the printer that says official media vehicle.
Authorized.
Yeah. That's the one that goes just for general use.
It's looking the joke. Right. You're not authorized to go in there.
That's when you get towed. They see that pass and they're like, "That guy's full of shit."
Yeah.
That sign's
going to look really cool in the impound lot.
That's why we shouldn't say anything podcast on it. Because we're like, podcast? That's not official. Yeah.
I keep waiting for people to call me on that when I'm like going to a booth like Twisted or something. I'm like, "Hi, can I talk to you guys? I'm on podcast."
Yeah, but yeah, I can see where, you know, having been a journalist and then been to press and tours and see like kind of who they select to go. I think that.
Have you looked at a motorcycle magazine lately?
Yeah, why?
They're like that big.
I know.
And all ads.
I know. Yeah. And I think that's why they're starting to accept a lot more, especially websites. Like, what, maybe 10 years ago, they were like, you know, what's this thing? Motorcycle.com.
Interwebs.
You know, now, those guys are getting invited to all kinds of stuff.
What?
But to me, where? It's not so much, I think it's about who you want to reach and who the audience is. You know, you may have a small following, but if you have a devoted and a select, like, it's not about the numbers. It's who are you reaching and how engaged are they? And so that's what I'm interested in. Who are you talking to?
Let me assure you, the Wheelnerd.
It's just a joke.
Tell your story, guys.
There
was this guy.
I was talking to a company, right? And I was doing my spiel.
Okay, wait. Keep think of this from the perspective of you're the company he's talking to.
Got it.
Right. And I hand you a business card and I say, "Hey, this is what I do. You know, this is some of the people that I work with. And I've heard about your product. I really like your product." People keep approaching me about your product and asking me what I think about your product, right? "So will you tell me about it?" And you tell me about it. I'm like, "Okay, great. You know, I'd love to test this out sometime, you know, and do some promotion and, you know, do a thorough review of this so I can, you know, be informed and tell the people who keep asking me about this, right?" And then you say, "Well, what's your social media following?" And then I say, "Well, you know, it's this much." And then you say, "That's not as good as our international Facebook following." And then you just walk away. How does that make you feel?
It's not good. Kind of like a Beulah rider.
Yeah. Yeah. But then what?
I'm so kidding.
But then what happens when you look up their social media following and find out that you have like 1,000 more followers than their social media following?
Ooh,
that's
yeah.
It's not good.
Yeah.
No, he's really kind of sugarcoating it because the guy that he was talking to was really helpful and was interested. And the guy that made that comment was like from the back.
Like a random guy popped up from behind the like
that works for the company.
Product.
That
why, yeah. Huh.
He's like, what's huge? There's so many places to go with that.
Yeah.
He said he's got a huge
opened himself up.
And you just, you, there was the, he threw it to you.
And he lost it on
your mother. And so.
It was telegraphed.
Yeah.
All the lines were there.
I just didn't do anything.
You were just too nice.
Yeah.
You were too nice.
I was too nice.
Well, you could have used your answer for that when the guy said that. Which would have been perfect.
I could have.
But then the guy didn't even like engage him after that.
No,
he just turned around and walked away.
The funny part was is the guy that I was talking to was like, I kind of was like, well, fuck you guys then. And I didn't say that. I go, okay, well, if I'm not big enough for you, you know, other companies are really, that's what I said. I said, other companies are really happy with, you know, but if I'm not big enough for you, that's fine. He's like, no. And I was like, oh, yeah.
What's that?
And I kind of walked away after that. I was just like, okay, great. Yeah, see you later. You know, it was kind of weird.
I really hope that nice guy went and kicked mean guy right in the crotch after that.
Like, what the fuck's wrong with you, man? Like, I just walked away.
That was a sure thing.
Like, do you even work here? Get out.
Where'd you get that shirt?
He doesn't. What?
Apparently, he might have been a family member from what we're.
Yeah, that's what that's what I heard later. Yeah.
Oh. He's like somebody's retarded cousin or something.
it's an old school way of thinking. I mean, I understand about getting, you know, return on investment and having trackable sort of...
It's not about the size of your following. It's how you use it.
It's very much about, No, it really is about quality, not quantity, I think.
No, but the point of the whole thing was, like, we were talking about, like... I think it's more of, like, a different mindset, like, how advertising is used and what kind of marketing tools are available. And it's like, okay... What is 10,000 followers on a Facebook account that you can pay to advertise on, you know, versus something that's actually like an organic form of getting your product?
I don't know how many are actually engaging with you. You can have 10,000 followers and don't even look at your posts.
You can have bought 10,000 followers.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's the reality.
Who are all, by the way, in like Middle Eastern countries that don't even speak your language. Because, mm-hmm. you know,
there are companies that'll set you up with that in no time. But the reality is, if you've got people emailing and asking your opinion, or people calling in and asking your opinion.
Exactly.
I mean,
yeah.
Well, what was funny. I was like trying to explain it to them. I'm like, yeah, people keep asking me about your product, you know, like whatever.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. Like, the ACF 50 guys, we're talking, we went and just chatted with them for a minute, you know, their corrosion blocker stuff and whatever. And we were like, so why can't we ever find any of this stuff in any retail locations? And they kind of, like, they didn't want to say what retailer they wanted to get into that wouldn't let them get in. But they're like, yeah, you know, they always say, like, well, there just isn't demand there. And so, like, do you have a card? Can we, like, we're collecting business cards and, like, notes from anybody that asks us, where's your product? Why can't I find it? So that I can go to the company and go, here's a bag full of people's names that want your freaking product. You know?
Like, it's funny because I've used corrosion block for years. Like when we had a Sea-Doo jet boat, you know, and they sell that like at Boat Owners Warehouse and West Marine. I never knew that ACF-50 was Lear Chemical was the same company. I heard about that from a podcast. I heard about it from Cleveland Moto, and they like talked about how great it was, and they became a dealer. Then I tried to find it locally. Can't find it.
Yeah,
it's like maybe it'll be listing some like aircraft maintenance company, but they don't actually stock it. They just we're like an Amsoil thing. We're a dealer, so we can buy it for all of our stuff. And that the reception we got from them was like really, really warm. Here, take samples. Matter of fact, after we left the booth, she tracked me down and like handed me a whole spray can of it. Take this, you know. So they see the value in us.
But you stinky.
We don't want to take it home.
If I come back with extras, they hurt me.
Meanwhile, part of the point of these shows, because if you all you ever got out of coming to a show like this, like it costs a lot of money to come down here, and if, you know, you're selling a product. If you only ever reach the people at the show, that would be kind of pointless. I mean, you're trying to sell to dealers who will sell to other people, but you have the retail side of it, and if you're only hitting that local retail market, bad as nothing. But it's the people that then go blog about it and talk about it on podcasts and make it more searchable terms. Like, that is the real value. And so that's where you can't discount the people that are connecting with others. Even it doesn't have to be a huge following. It's without the people that are getting online and doing this, there's not.
I also kind of feel like the participation we get is more active than it is from print media.
Yeah.
I mean, we really have...
And it's more personable. I mean, like, I've been listening to podcasts for years, and, like, when you meet some of these people for the first time, or when you engage with them via email or whatever, like, there's this sort of odd, like, one-sided familiarity where, like, you've been listening to their voice or watching a video of them for a long time, and so, like, you...
They've been watching you for a long time.
Sometimes they're a little too familiar, yeah. Or maybe you're a little too familiar, but there's a rapport that you've sort of developed with your fans... or your listeners or your audience, whatever term you want to use, that, you know, print media, it's like
you don't have.
I mean, great example, I didn't realize I was like this far from Mark Cook because I don't really remember what he looks like. And I've never heard his voice.
Yeah.
But like, I could pick out, like, James, I've heard your voice forever, so like, you know, I could face it, like, as soon as you start talking, like, oh wait, James is here. Like,
somebody walked up to me last year at AIM. And said, "You're from Cafe Racer." You guys, like, you had a really different voice. I recognized it. And we started talking. He was a local guy. And it was kind of, and, you know, we're not pretentious, normal, regular guys who like to ride motorcycles. And everybody's got a varying level of experience. Some guys have been riding for years. Some guys haven't. But it's like, I don't know. Maybe we're more approachable.
And how many emails or Facebook posts or anything have you guys gotten that you have not replied to in some way?
I was just about to bring that up.
Every single one.
Like,
right.
You know, a big company, you shoot off an email. Like, what's it about? And you might get a generic response. You might not get anything. But, I mean, I respond to all the emails. Mm-hmm. You know, at least, like, I don't know anything about that. But thanks for contacting me, you know.
I've actually had phone conversations with people. I've called them because, like, I didn't want to go through this long dissertation on an email and said, hey, here's my idea about what you're talking about, but here's also my phone number. Give me a call. And, you know, like, we actually have, like, people that listen to all the shows that we all know, John Jones, Quentin List. You know, John I've had conversations with about stuff. We're kind of, like, in the same field a little bit, you know. Hell, he was going to, like, bring the modus down.
Oh yeah!
If you didn't have to go to that event out in California, and you're like, you can ride it if you want. I'm gonna have it down here. So I don't know. I just kind of think that as this media grows and more people, well, for instance, just look at what happened with Serial. You familiar with Serial?
The podcast.
Not
Serial.
Like, not
Serial.
Stuff you eat.
I was in this box of Raisin Bran. So
Serial, and it was. A story that was done 12 episodes from This American Life, NPR. Sarah Koenig was the reporter that did it. It was a story about a guy that was arrested for a crime and convicted of murder. That show had 5 million downloads per show. Mm. It was so big that Saturday Night Live parodied it. Overnight, it woke people up to what podcasts were. People didn't even know what a podcast was, and all of a sudden, like, I'll have a conversation with Chuck last night about a podcast I never heard about that I'm listening to. It's growing and growing and growing and growing. There's a lot of them that come up too, like, even in our realm, there's been some podcasts that are Cafe Racer related. ADB, we were talking about this today, that lasted like 5 shows. Mm-hmm. You know, they got in and they realized, oh crap, this is kind of a little bit of work and there's a commitment to it, you know. And my show, we were talking, my show sucks, and now I gotta like invest in gear and
it sucks editing.
Yeah.
That's why you just give up on editing and just put whatever crap.
Exactly.
I mean, 44 minutes of silence, people.
Yeah.
44 minutes?
Yeah.
44 spectacular minutes.
I'm going to have to fix that.
Of your rich beard.
Exactly.
Yeah, 44 minutes of beard.
I can't put the Wheel Nerds out on edited. No one wants to hear that.
we
not even a mother could love that.
The audio gets edited.
Especially a mother.
We don't. We started editing when we first started the show. I would spend like all day Saturday editing, and we were doing music drop-ins and all this stuff.
Yep.
And then, Chris and I sat down and talked, and I was like, "Look, I need to go ride on Saturday, so we can't do this anymore." So
we talk about motorcycling, but I haven't actually done any motorcycling.
Exactly, that was the conversation, and I was like, "Look, we're gonna hit go. We're gonna talk for as long as we talk. We're gonna hit stop. we're going to drop the intro music in, we're going to cut off the end, and it ships. Mm-hmm. And that was it. And that's how we've done the show.
Our workflow is down to less than an hour. Yeah. I mean, there is an edit a little bit, not much, but it's just mostly, you know, putting some compression, running it through Alphonic. Yeah. We've got an algorithm that we like, and that's it.
Yeah.
It takes 3 hours to produce an episode.
Not counting.
3 hours.
Not counting listening to it. It takes me 10 minutes.
But you guys will edit stuff out, though, right?
We edit a lot of stuff out.
We can't because we're live.
You do bits, right? You do some scripted stuff. Yeah. It's a whole different.
Yeah, you have a different experience.
We're a very weird experience.
And you gotta invite that guy Billy over all the time. But
yeah, you know, we stop. We script stuff up. We discuss things before we do it. We do it.
We had show times. Notes once.
They didn't work.
We do show notes every show. For a while.
I guess like through panel sketches and stuff and like.
Yeah, for the first couple seasons, we printed out our show notes. We stopped when they got to about this.
We started that. We were like sharing a document on Google Drive and like, forget this. Right?
We still do the Google Drive. We just do it off the screen now. But it's just.
We're completely unscripted.
And I'm slow and drunk usually when I'm editing. High as a kite. So I don't even know what day it is when I'm doing this thing. So. It takes me a while. I'm very slow.
I don't know. So hopefully, I guess the whole point of this is the manufacturers will like get on board with what we're doing. I think the experience we had, most of them were, for the most part.
How come Twisted Throttle isn't doing any stuff for a Beautylicious anymore?
Or a Moto Guzzi Stelvio.
Really?
Why is there not one Moto Guzzi Stelvio on board?
That's only because they're not doing stuff for the Ulysses anymore. They just have it left over.
That counts?
No. I could buy it.
There's a crap load of Bongo stuff. I mean, there's a couple people picking bones. If I'm going to pick a random bone about Twisted Throttle. So when you look up the TT100 on there, it lists the RNG skid plate.
Oh, God.
The RNG skid plate will not mount with the SW Motec craft bars installed.
Not with that attitude, Mr.
I own the crash bars. And it's not even on the bike in the picture.
It didn't happen.
I was like...
Have you tried some lube?
Crisco.
They just don't. You know? They don't go.
Some parts are mutually exclusive. I mean,
I know. It just was funny to me that it was listed. I was like, why did I listen to
that? Like
because it's an option. It's like either or, not an and.
You know, some relationship.
You should get a big disclaimer on there. Do not order this part if you order this part.
I don't really know
what
I meant by that, but I think that made sense.
Some things.
No, I know what you mean. Like, I get it. I had to pick on something.
That's it. I mean, it's because our stuff is so finely tuned. It's a bike specific fit.
Oh no, the SW Motec crash bars are beautiful.
So there is no like
fit.
Yeah, there's no wiggle room there. Almost. I mean, it's.
I'm curious to see what's going to happen when the Denali line expands.
Yeah.
To more stuff, and then the manufacturers are like, "Well, why'd you make that? We make it."
You mean.
Like your line. Oh, I'm talking about just expanding that out into other things.
Yeah, I mean, like
lights and horns now. What's next?
Yeah,
crash bars?
My
bags? You guys dry spec yours, right?
Yeah, so I mean, Denali's really more about electronics. I think, actually, to be honest,
when the Twisted Throttle brand expands, whatever you want to call it, whether it's Denali dry spec or Knuter valve. You know,
I remember talking to the Altrider guys, and they work pretty close with like BMW, or you know, at least
we do some OEM
work.
I had a conversation with Kevin about taking a particular motorcycle that doesn't exist right now, picking it up in New Hampshire, and having them build parts for it as an OEM. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, because we can do a lot of prototyping and.
But do you get any pushback from OEMs about it? Like, no, we're planning to do that. So.
Because really,
no,
we do that though. That's the thing.
Some of our stuff, no, because
there's not a lot of
ideas
that want to get into that market and make that. They want to make the bike, and that's it.
Yeah,
that's why they're not building bags. I mean, who builds bags? OEM, nobody.
BMW.
Huh?
Well, shit, no. TourTech makes BMW's bags.
Yeah, either Shad's making them if they're plastic, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they're branding them. I mean, Moto Guzzi's OEM bag is Trax. It's SW Motec.
An OEM bag.
GB's OEM.
Well, except for certain aspects of like the hard BMW bags.
Those Brario cases are garbage. I'm sorry. Yeah. With that adjustable crap in there that breaks every time.
The bags on the new F800 GT are nice.
Yeah.
The side cases on the new one. The side cases on the old one
you
were
really
kind of
like
tiny.
That.
I do like that.
Well, the particular ones I'm thinking of, we've been talking a lot about the 1290 Super Adventure, the KTM. They made fucking clamshell cases for that thing. It's a, how many, it's 20, almost 25 grand, like probably fully loaded. Mm-hmm. And they put clamshell cases on it. It's like, what the hell?
Is it the Hepco Becker cases? Or?
No, it's like they're plastic and they're the KTM power part or whatever, but they like clamshell open. It's like, who, that's not a good idea. Like, I don't know, I prefer, and you can't get it without it because it's like ready to set up.
Really?
Like, package. Seriously? Yeah, because if there was a way to like take all that crap off it and I'll put a nice set of hard luggage on there, because, and it's almost like they push it with that now, and I don't know. I would much prefer to pick up you know, a nice aftermarket set. A
solid purpose build.
Or not, yeah. What if you don't want to even go hard bags? What if you're going to go soft bags?
Yeah.
You know?
A lot of
that's
people.
A dumb way. Now, I didn't realize you couldn't buy that bike.
That, well, that's kind of pretty specific with that bike.
It's their adventure package.
Super adventure. Yeah.
Well, to answer your question, I mean, the thing is, we will always be coming out with new products because that's part of the fun. I mean, that's part of the fun.
No, you guys would. Last couple of years we've made some great new stuff. Yeah.
Some awesome stuff. But I actually, but part of it too is not just confining ourselves to the motorcycle market. I mean, there's a whole off-road market with all kinds of vehicles out there that could use these. And so we're also,
are you telling
thinking,
us something new that's,
oh, like am I spilling the beans?
Yeah.
No. I mean, I'm just,
like, is there like a Jeep line coming out from Twisted Throttle?
That no, would but be cool.
Was you it can
hard bags for a Jeep?
Not yet. No, there's nothing
you
I
can
know
get soft
of
bags for Jeep.
But I will say that we, especially the Nolly Lights themselves, have a lot of applications for other vehicles.
Oh, yeah.
And we're working on how we might make that an easier transition, what kinds of mounts and things. Because that's, I mean, there's all kinds of people having ventures out there beyond just two wheels. So
well, what surprised,
that, I think, is what we're,
what yeah. surprised me in the Twisted Throttle booth today was the number of accessories you guys are doing for the new Vulcan. The Vulcan S.
That is RNG. This is a sport bike protection company that, you know, for almost 20 years has only done really sport bikes, sport toys. This is the very first time they've ever done a cruiser. Yeah. And it got a ton of attention at the show.
Are they a UK-based company or US? Yep. They're UK-based.
Yeah, we are the US distributor. Right. And that bike got more. And, you know, they had a Panigale out there, too.
I saw that.
Beautiful Ducati. Everybody looked at the Vulcan.
Yeah.
It was hilarious. Like, we figured
this
Panigale.
Yeah, nobody was standing by the Ducati at all today.
We were positive. Everyone's going to be, like, you know, flocking to the Ducati because it's so beautiful, and people could not stop looking at the Vulcan.
So it was the Panigale Paul Pellin's bike.
Yeah.
Right.
115,000 miles, never been washed.
And then the Vulcan on the other side.
Yeah.
Did you hear Paul telling the story about the dirt on his bike?
No.
We were like breaking his chops and his spray can dirt and all that. He goes, I was at an event where the bike was on display. And I'm standing there, and the guy didn't know I was the owner, and he was just like telling everybody, that's BS. They made that bike look like it's been ridden like that. There's no way that it can get like that. That this part doesn't work like this. They just cobbled this thing up to make it look like it's been ridden all over. And he said, I'm just sitting there laughing.
Yeah, he said he didn't even have the heart to tell him, like, I'm the owner of that bike, and I put 115,000 miles on it.
Yeah.
If you're going to see him tomorrow, ask him to show you the pictures of his clutch.
He probably would have argued with him.
Yeah.
Did you see that?
No, I didn't.
You're lying.
So Paul says the thing starts making noise. He went 30,000 more miles with it, like, grenading, self-destructing.
Yeah, it was the clutch basket just going to hell.
He kept thinking it was a tensioner for the cam chain. And he's like, tightening the cam chain tensioner.
Yeah.
It's just a cam chain tensioner. It's probably
he changed it out so you have the adjustable one. And he's like, keep putting the bolt in. Nothing's happening, you know. And all of a sudden, in the middle of nowhere, the thing. And he called Twisted Throttle. Like,
actually,
Eric,
he did. Eric gave him a bike. We brought his bike back to our shop. And that's where I met Paul, is when he was up in Exeter. We were fixing his bike.
You guys open it up.
I mean, you got to just.
It comes out.
He did that drain the oil like four times and kept flushing it. And more metal parts are coming out. He fixed it.
Yeah.
Then he realizes that the engine case was cracked after Yamaha like overnighted him a new clutch basket. So he cleans everything out, you know, puts it all back together again. That thing's leaking oil. Oh. He gets it home, he JB welds it, and that's the same motor that he's running.
Yep.
That's awesome.
Is Twisted Throttle the ones doing that was developing stuff for Urals?
Actually, I know, I don't know what's going on right now, but I know Eric, our owner, had been talking to Ural. He's pretty close with them.
I remember, like, last year at Americade,
there was
some stuff together that they were talking to. The Ural guys were talking about, I thought, if it was Twisted or not, that was, like, going
to
develop some stuff.
To find out. Yep, there was some discussion.
If it's a seat and it's not made by Ridge Mond, then I don't think the Ural guys are going to care at all.
I just want speakers. I need in the subwoofers with flashy lights.
What would be, like, your ideal accessories for that? I mean,
a sound system.
Yeah, but, yeah, but there's plenty of room.
And a public address.
But you can't have outward-facing speakers.
Only in Florida.
Okay.
In Utah, I can have all
We got
I
that
want.
Text last night.
You can't have beer, but you can have a PA.
Right, it's Utah.
Yeah, yeah, because you can't get drunk and yell. You can just yell.
I want PA and a sound system is what I want.
And a whip antenna.
Really?
Yes.
And a CB.
Huh?
And a CB radio.
A CB radio. Really, I just want a sound system. But like, that's what made me so happy about writing the Can-Am today.
But, I mean, wouldn't that be fairly easy to do, though?
The two Bluetooth speakers, like duct tape to the handlebars, and you're ready to go.
And look OEM.
There was that one booth today at AIM Expo with the flashy speaker light thing. I was like, I want to Velcro that to my bike. That would be awesome.
Yes.
And the guy's like, it's a show special, $220. You can take it home right now. But if it looked more like it fit with the Euro, that's, you know, something utilitarian.
So just buy...
Like a speaker in the Denali D1 housing. Because that thing looks rugged as hell.
Yeah.
It's so, like, so flip it around and face it at the driver.
I have just very shallow knees.
Go get, clearly, but just one of the sound systems that's built for Harleys and then beat the crap out of it with a ball-peen hammer.
Paint it green.
Paint it green. Mm-hmm. It'll look perfect on the Euro.
Good point. So any accessories we did make would pretty much have to come, like, pre-distressed.
Take them off Paul's bike.
Yeah, let Paul take all your Euro accessories for a month.
Yeah. What does the Euro rider really need?
Chuck.
Besides stereo.
A good toolkit.
A second motorcycle.
Yeah.
You know, all you really need is a rock and vodka. You can fix 99% of the problems.
Did you read that article about they did the iron butt on a Euro and broke down and like the push rod like literally like disintegrated, and they were like talking to Ural, and the advice in this magazine article, literally the advice to the guy was put metal in it. Just put something metal in there.
Ivan's in there like, yes, stick
you have screwdriver.
In USA, you put the metal.
Do you have anything metal? Put it in there.
Just coat hanger?
Put the metal.
Why are you talking to me? Drink more, put in, it'd be fine. I don't know.
I'm just wondering, how much do you have to hate yourself to want to do an iron butt on a Ural?
I would do an iron butt on my KTM 690. That's because everybody gets so squirrely about the, you can't tour on that bike.
Now that, I mean, that makes perfect sense.
I know. There's people that do it on ruckuses.
Paul rode
that much
Boston
time. I mean, wouldn't that just beat you up?
Chicago.
That much time on the highway?
Scooter in a blue tuxedo with a top hat on.
Yeah. Like, mine's got really good.
We just hosted Ed March.
So,
but I mean, don't you have to
fight
the steering wheel?
Yeah.
No,
not really.
Yeah, people are doing it on C90s. They're going around the world. Yeah.
Posty bikes, man.
A monkey at
what?
Top,
posty bikes. Australia. They buy these huge postal bikes. Yeah. This guy's been all over the world.
But people, people that have never done a big tour or anything are like, yeah, no, you need more horsepower. No, you need more luggage capacity. No, you need more wind protection.
There's the guys on the Goldwings with multiple GPSs, like, going completely crazy, but...
They've got like radar front and back. Oh yeah,
we like them.
Was it? Yeah.
Well, yeah, because they're like, let me see the tour tech catalog. I'll take two of everything.
All of
that. Yes.
Yeah.
I need highway pegs. That's what I need for my girl.
You got highway pegs. They're on the side. Just sit side saddle. You can just put your feet up.
Prop your feet up on the front of the car.
And put a little pillow on there.
I've ridden side saddle on my Bonneville, so you can definitely do it.
Wow.
Yeah, like I'll pick my foot up.
When you ride in a skirt,
the skirt, it's really tough in a skirt.
Is it tight skirt or is it loose?
Pencil skirt.
Yeah, pencil skirt.
Pencil skirt. Really?
I'm just looking at that stuff I got to go to the bathroom. It's like so disgusting.
But yeah, I mean, you can totally just put your feet up on the car.
But I've got like you know, engine guards on it.
Yeah,
I put my feet up on that. But I keep thinking, yeah, I need a pair of pegs.
Can't you just put your feet up on top of the cylinders?
Yeah,
I guess I could. It's not as comfortable.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't know. It looks. I saw somebody at the Tour Tech rally on an HP2 just kick their feet out over the cylinder heads, and it looked super comfortable.
Like a lot of the BMWs, the cylinder heads have like a swing out pegs that you can just kick them out. That'd be kind of cool if I could put that
It always scared the crap out of me, though. Like, well, at least on like a GS, if it, you caught one of those pegs on something, it just
fold in, right?
Yeah, I know, but still, if it was going down and it caught it the wrong way, it just ripped your cylinder.
Or if you're going in reverse on the Euro and you just catch that, and it explodes, obviously. That's what it would do. It's Russian.
And then you would put some metal in it. And it'd be good.
Some metal and some vodka.
That should be a shirt. Like, Euro, put some metal in it.
Well, like, the joke with the Euro guys is hit it with a rock.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a joke?
Well, okay, it's practical advice, but that is the first step is hit it with a rock. That lets her know.
BMW guys just throw a credit card at it.
That's the BMW
push the universal button, like tool. BMW helicopter comes.
The BMW universal tool.
Got my multi-tool.
For the Euro, it's a rock. And a bottle of vodka. That's all you get in the repair kit is a little thing of vodka, a little rock, and a metal rod.
Use this for
on a piece of metal.
They've added that as the new 2016 tool.
Actually, our owner Eric likes to say, you know, he talks about like good bikes for adventuring and talking about your trip coming up and KLRs and stuff. Like a KLR is an easy bike to break, but it's hard to kill.
Oh yeah.
Whereas BMWs are hard to break, but they're really easy to kill.
Yeah.
Once you do, it's over. Like once you break it. So I thought that was pretty astute.
Yeah, there's so many things to fry on a BMW.
And you're pretty much screwed. Once if you're out there at KLR, you'll break it easily and you'll fix it.
Yeah, and BMW is totally different, you know, where just the electrical issues alone that separate the two of them, it's like ridiculous.
Oh, the CAN bus system. Oh, something goes wrong in there.
Yeah.
Forget it.
Yeah, putting in electronics and tricking the CAN bus system into thinking that you're not trying to tap into its brain is ridiculous.
Oh, yeah, it's like troubleshooting your nervous system, right?
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
With a wrench and a screwdriver.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Tapping that in. Do you feel that? No.
I mean, so
it's like the movie Her, you know? What are you doing?
Yeah.
Cat by the bed?
I work at a helicopter squadron, and like we just started working with these UAVs that have CAN bus. And I was like, oh God, it's a BMW motorcycle. We're all screwed.
The technology is growing.
This is the new BMW helicopter. You're going to push it, and a UAV is going to come drag your ass out of the woods.
Do you guys make any parts for the KLRs?
We have a ton of stuff.
Do you? Yeah. I'm going to have to look at the catalog.
Oh, my gosh.
You can make
a
whole new bike out of it?
Or? Oh, man. Yeah. I mean, we, as far as manufacturing ourselves, like, we sell parts. So the companies we partner with should be, we've got a ton of stuff specifically made for that bike.
Yeah. I don't know. I've recently had a change of heart with them. Not that I ever hated them or anything, but just recently I went riding with somebody that was on one. And he just embarrassed me with how well he rode on this bone stock KLR, you know.
And he didn't have a styrofoam cooler?
No, not even a basket. There wasn't even...
No milk crate.
Yeah. But, that's where I kind of got the idea to take those bikes on the Continental Divide trip, is it's a very approachable bike. You know, they're inexpensive, pretty much...
It's like one of the top choices of world travelers.
Yeah.
Yeah. I
mean, because it's not the maybe fastest, best performing. But it's not the world's greatest.
It's not sexy.
Cycle,
it's not.
But it's solid. It's, you know, mostly reliable. And if it breaks, you can fix it. You can find parts for it. You can do a lot with very few tools.
There's even parts in the woods you can find for it. They're left over.
I mean, on your Continental Divide trip, you're going to have a lot more
rocks.
You'll probably have a lot of dumb new rider mistakes breaking some of the KLR. But you'll have the KTM just eating itself. Like, slowly
the KTM, my KTM literally tries to kill itself. Like, it eats its blood while it's running. So it's like, if you don't pay enough attention to me, I'm gonna die.
But the amazing thing is, you keep trying to get me to buy one.
Because you need one. Everybody needs one. Like, it's not the same. Like,
join
I'm just saying, once you're with us, you don't leave us. You know, the same people ride the 990s and stuff, you know? Like, those things are... They're animals.
Yeah.
I want a KTM once in my life, just to...
I really want one of the 390s.
Before I'm too old.
Oh, one of the 390 Dukes. They needed to make the 390 Adventure. They were talking about the 390 Adventure. I had a friend that put a deposit down at KTM of Seattle. He said... He said, I don't know if they're making it or not, but here's $500 that says I get the first one.
Yep.
Holy crap. Hey, speaking of small adventure bikes, what feedback have you gotten on that Chinese thing?
The CSC. I've heard great things.
Yeah. I've heard, I mean...
I'm surprised we didn't see one there.
We've talked to a couple people who have bought them.
Mm-hmm.
They're all West Coast. The problem with them is that there's no place to get them serviced.
There's
one place to buy them. So, you know, if you live on the East Coast and you want to buy one, all of a sudden the price isn't all that attractive because now you've got...
Is it a single or a twin?
Is it a twin? I don't remember.
The other issue was the service interval.
Yeah.
And to kind of dispel those rumors, the company did a tour this summer.
The Mexico tour.
Yeah, right. Where they took a bunch of... was it press people or new owners?
No, new owners.
It was new owners, and they were like, we can show you how you can do this. And that's where I kind of tuned into it then to see how it went. And it seems like it went well.
Yeah, from what I understand, though, the engine is very proprietary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not like the Indian bikes where they all knocked off the same Honda motor.
Yeah.
Right? So a lot of the parts have to come from CSC. They're the only importer.
Yeah.
So, you know, that could get a little dicey.
Overland Expo, I thought he was like Paul Smith from...
I thought they were that... Well, for the East Coast one or the West Coast
one? The West Coast one.
I don't know. Did they have one there?
What? At the Overland?
Yeah.
I didn't see one. Or no, actually no, I did. I did see them there, but I
felt like one of the editors from like ADV magazine.
I don't know if Bob was there. Maybe he was. I don't know.
Well, you were there.
I know,
but it was Snowbird.
I was seriously. It was the least social like expo motorcycle event I've ever been to because everybody was freezing and miserable. Wet and miserable and like hiding in their tents. It was like a bummer. You know, because you like, I went all the way from Seattle down there to like, you know, do stuff, hang out with people.
We had a good time when we went, but it was like the weather was cool.
Yeah.
Like
I said, we're all going back this year. So
Rawhide had like the mirror ball going. You know, 2:30 in the morning they were partying. They had like guys scratching records and stuff, and it was just
well, I'm planning on being out there with a camper trailer. So if the weather all goes to hell,
then I'll be sleeping on the floor. Yeah,
that's what I need for the Euro is turntables. two turntables and a microphone.
Yeah,
right on the back rack.
Here I thought he was going to go into like the camping equipment. You know, he's like, "That's what I need." We're talking camping, and I'm like, "Nope." And practical? No.
You haven't spent nearly enough time with Chuck.
You know what would be kind of neat? Or too much?
I don't think
it's really
one or the other. It's hard to say.
Yeah.
You could do with the Earl probably, but what would be kind of neat is a sidecar rig, where instead of it's a sidecar, it's like a pop up trailer.
I've seen some like that.
They've actually
like
made
pop up.
Yeah, I like the pop up camper. Yeah.
Matter of fact, you know that what's that trailer called with one wheel on it? The egg looking.
The Unigo.
Unigo. Yeah.
Yeah.
I've seen actual things a little bit bigger than that. Mm. That was a popped up camper for motorcycle.
Oh, dude, hit the motorcycle camping
super
group.
Cute. It's cool.
Was a sidecar, that would be cool. I mean, you have to go to like Claude Stanley or someone to custom build it, but that would be neat.
Yeah, strip the tub down just the frame and put a little pop-up.
There's a guy, I don't know if you guys have seen this, the guy that
has Airstream. A club. You need a single-person Airstream trailer stuck for a tub.
There's a guy down in Miami.
Tub of Crisco, and you just slip right on in.
He's got a Moto Guzzi, like, Ambassador or one of the older Eldorados with, like, a sidecar that's flat that he carries around like a little cafe bike on there.
Oh, yeah.
So it's a bike carrying a bike, yeah. That's pretty neat.
I've seen some of the custom sidecar rigs that are... See that? That would be cool. Is that functional as a camper, or is that just made up to look like
it's probably a joke, but that was the first thing
my wife would want that.
Or you could get the bubble, the little bubble tent and trailer thing you can ride a motorcycle in. Just put that on a flat sidecar.
It's adorable.
It's like a food truck.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
Super cute.
God, every time you stop somebody, with one
hashtag super cute.
You're like, hey, can I get some street tacos? You're like, no,
if I could get a Zeus. If I could get a Zeus in this country, that would be awesome.
A Zeus. What is that?
It is a sidecar, purpose-built sidecar rig. The motor is in the middle of the entire vehicle.
Huh.
It kind of looks like a scooter. and the sidecar is a side by side, so you can fit two people. It's completely enclosed.
It's called a car.
Air conditioning. It's heated. It's like a car, but it's
so wait. It's like a car where the driver is outside.
Is on a motorcycle. Yeah.
Why not get a Miata?
Because you can't cover up your passengers, and.
Hannigan made something like that, didn't they? Hannigan sidecars had like a whole bubble thing that closed.
Yeah. And they're just like,
The Zeus is just really cool because it's, I mean, the motor is midship of the thing, actually, so it changes the handling.
Yeah, that does.
Hannigan made a sidecar rig based off of a Bandit where the wheels tilted. You remember that thing?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that was kind of cool too. You could ride it like a motorcycle.
I saw the Zeus in Amsterdam. It was badass. And I wasn't stoned or drunk or anything.
All right, so I think we're starting to wind this down.
Yeah.
What do you guys think?
We're looking at
6 hours.
Yeah, 7 hours. 6 hours, yeah. 7 hours,
and only five of it was silent.
Just right. Bored, so like we're not talking about her products anymore. So.
This isn't over until you finish that, though.
Look at the mold growing right out of it already.
You better do it fast because it's only going to get worse the warmer it gets.
Nasty. Oh, all right.
Has everyone here tried it at least?
No.
You and I were just the two dumb ones.
No, I tried.
Try it after you.
I tried.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, okay.
All right, let's crash. Final thoughts.
Come on.
Final thoughts.
Final.
Final thoughts. Everybody at AIM Expo needs their press kit on a freaking USB stick.
Indeed. Yep.
Also,
wait, you got mine,
this
right?
Isn't, yes. I was just going to say, your press kit was the best press kit.
Really?
The Nutri-Grain bars, which I forgot about and didn't eat. The aspirin, the laundry detergent. I used that last night. Like, seriously.
I found the candy bars later, and I was
really that was really awesome.
I had the Crunch bar last night. Was liquefied by the time I found it, but I'm going to eat that Butterfinger in a minute.
That's all I needed to hear. Gear dude.
Press kits was good. AIM Expo is tiring, and I don't know how you're going to do it for another 2 days.
Oh, man. Yeah, I'm not really sure either. That's my final thought is, oh, good
Monster.
Lord.
Energy drinks.
Yeah, I need some sleep tonight, and then I have a long day ahead tomorrow.
Yeah, that's going to be a zoo.
What time is it open tomorrow?
Talking to
nobody. At 9, breakfast at 8. And it'll be 9 to 6. It's a long day, right?
9 to 6 on Saturday, yeah.
No, I think it's 7, actually.
What? Is it really?
Oh, God.
Wow.
Ouch. Yeah, it's not really about us exhibitors. Comfort, you know, it's all about the
people. You guys should work in shifts.
Yeah, we kind of should.
I used to work DEMA, diving trade show for a dive manufacturer. And one year, we had somebody with the bright idea of putting wood floor in our booth. And we had a thing about not being able to sit down. Like, some of the dive companies had chairs and stuff. Not us. Wood floor. No padding. Like, you go into the rabbit booth, man, they had, like, 100 ounce
when
padding.
You, when you're walking around, like, you notice when you accidentally walk
somebody
into
had
somebody's booth.
Fake wood flooring that was actually cushy, padding.
That's my final thought.
Better floors.
No, you could make a ton of money if you were a masseuse just doing foot massages. Or
you can kill it. Just set up right outside. Right outside.
I bet they're open for the public one.
Oh my gosh!
Tomorrow,
that's what I'm doing next year. I'm just gonna come down and make money massage. No, actually, I'm not gonna make money massaging people's feet. It sounds kind of gross, but somebody could. Somebody could do it.
I'm gonna hire somebody to do that, and I'm gonna take some money off the top.
There you go. All
right. Steve.
I'm just glad to be here. No, it was great. Yeah.
Just glad I made it.
Yeah.
I'm glad I'm alive.
The best thing I heard out of anyone's mouth was Crash saying the having the media kit and the catalogs on a USB drive because I don't want to be hauling around.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, for us, it's easy immediately to be able to go on, like Spencer did yesterday, high-res images and stuff from a press release. Yeah. It would be great. No, it's just I'm truly, really happy to be here with these guys who I like a lot, you know, in the show and everything.
And Chuck.
James?
Yeah, that's a really good point. This is pretty much the only time we get to actually spend any time together in person all year, right?
Yeah.
So that's big. That's huge. Other than that, I think I'm done thinking for the day.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, I got no final thoughts. I was just using you guys to do it for me.
Fair enough.
Super cute.
Hashtag super cute.
Hashtag totes super cute.
All right, so that's it. Thanks for listening, everyone. We'll all see you on our respective shows, and Jessica will see you on twistedthrottle.com. And ride safe, Nova, whatever closing I do for my show. Yay, bye.
Yeah.
All right, so.